See, sometimes our theology can actually be a hindrance to us experiencing all that God has for us.
It's only His true name revealed to us in the Word of God that saves, heals, and restores the world.
Because there is no other name but the name of Jesus Christ.
He is my light, my strength, my song.
Names are important in our culture. Couples expecting a baby pore over books in search of the perfect name for their child. Entertainers sometimes give themselves a stage name that's more memorable than their own. A name is not just a means of identification, but it can represent what that person means to us. As Brett McBride continues this series in the book of Acts, we're reminded again of the centrality of the name Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Both then and now, there is no other name more important or more powerful in this world. This is Living Truth.
Good morning. You can turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 4. We've been going through the book of Acts. Let me just refresh your memory as to what's taken place last week. That brings us to what we're going to read about this week. Last week, we looked at Acts chapter 3, Peter and John on their way into the temple at Jerusalem, see a man lame from birth begging at the beautiful gate, sensitive to the Spirit's leading, walk up to that man, and God heals the man through Peter reaching out to him and saying, in the name of Jesus Christ, walk. The man jumps to his feet, starts jumping and praising God within the temple. And a crowd gathers around Peter and John, and we looked last week at how Peter and John start to describe the new covenant relationship that God has established with His people, that they were to actually let go of their old covenant legal relationship with God, and He's inviting them into a covenant based on grace and the finished work of Jesus Christ. And while Peter and John are sharing this message, the temple guard, because this is taking place within their walls, are there listening, and the priests are listening carefully as they see this commotion take place. And Peter and John make a statement that the people had acted in ignorance when they crucified Jesus, as did their leaders. Certainly this would capture the attention of the priests and the religious elite of Jesus' day. And we find the religious leaders' response to what Peter and John have declared within the temple in Acts chapter 4. But before we look into that, let me just share a few thoughts with you. A few years ago, about 5 or 6 years ago, I decided, I don't know whether it was in a midlife crisis moment, that I would run a marathon. That is 42.2 kilometers, 26 miles. That's from here past Oshawa. You just keep going on the 401. It's ridiculous. Are there any runners in the room courageous enough to put up your hand? If you're a runner, please just raise your hand for a moment. There's a few. Okay, we got to work on this group and get you people into shape. We runners are a bit demented, sick, twisted people that like to torture our bodies. Yesterday, I went for a 12-kilometer run. I find it very therapeutic to be brought to my physical limits at my wit's end and just pound whatever stress or anxiousness you're experiencing in life and just take it out on a run. But I remember running, preparing to get ready for this marathon, and I had worked hard for 6 months, watched what I ate pretty much, except for blizzards from Dairy Queen, had been pretty diligent in my routine of running and upping my distance so that I could run the distance. And it was 2 nights before race day, I went and picked up my kit, and when I opened my kit and looked at my bib that they had given me, they happened to put the wrong name on my bib. My name is Brett, and it was Alan. And I remember thinking to myself, that's great, I'm gonna run this race, it's too late to change the name on the bib, and my time will be under some guy named Alan. Who knows how many Allens are running? There was 5,000 runners in the marathon. 20,000 runners in the races that were going on that day, so I thought, I won't even be able to see how well I did. And it wasn't until halfway through the race that day that I realized whenever I ran by crowds of people and they were cheering for Alan, they were actually cheering for me. I'm running along and I'm thinking to myself, who is this Alan person that everybody's screaming for? Because they'd be like, come on, Alan, keep going, you got this. And I'm looking around, I'm like, I'm by myself. There's just a few vultures swirling to eat Alan, whoever he is. Oh, wait a second, I'm Alan. And it was on that day that I realized there is importance in our names. Certainly as parents, when you're getting ready for that little bundle of joy that keeps you up all night, you are agonizing over names. You read different books to find different definitions. The McBride household just bought a puppy a few weeks ago, the bane of my existence, because he's eating everything in the house. But we spent a few days agonizing over a name of a dog. We love to name things. And a name is important. It is literally the words by which something is known. If I said a series of names from history, it would conjure up different images for you. Let me give you an example. If I said the name Mother Teresa, a certain image would come into your mind, a definition of who that person is. If I said the name Adolf Hitler, something different might come into your mind. If I said Mahatma Gandhi, again, a different image would come into your mind. A name can be good, and a name can be bad. It can come to represent something very evil. And we say things like, he has a good name, meaning they're a trustworthy person, full of integrity. Or we say their name got dragged through the mud, meaning that something happened and their name isn't so good anymore. Well, in Acts chapter 4, we learn that there is a name that stands out amongst all other names in human history. And I just want to take a few moments this morning to bring this name before you and attempt to understand all the implications attached to it. Remember, God has instituted a new covenant relationship with his people. Peter and John have started to declare it, and it has caught the attention of the religious leaders and elders of Israel within the temple in Jerusalem. And we pick up the story in Acts chapter 4, verse 1. We read the following. The priests and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. They were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. They seized Peter and John, and because it was evening, they put them in jail until the next day. But many who heard the message believed, and the number of men grew to about 5,000. The next day, the rulers, elders, and teachers of the law met in Jerusalem. Annas, the high priest, was there. And so were Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and the other men of the high priest family. They had Peter and John brought before them and began to question them. By what power or what name did you do this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a cripple and are asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. He is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the capstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. When they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished. And they took note that these men had been with Jesus. But since they could see the man who had been healed standing there with them, there was nothing they could say. So they ordered them to withdraw from the Sanhedrin and then conferred together. What are we going to do with these men? They asked. Everybody living in Jerusalem knows they have done an outstanding miracle, and we cannot deny it. But to stop this thing from spreading any further among the people, we must warn these men to speak no longer to anyone in this name. Then they called them in again and commanded them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, judge for yourselves whether it is right in God's sight to obey you rather than God, for we cannot help speaking about what we have seen and heard. After further threats, they let them go. They could not decide how to punish them because all the people were praising God for what had happened. For the man who was miraculously healed was over 40 years old. What I want to talk about this morning is the confines of careless theology, the courage of truth, and the centrality of the name of Jesus. Let's start with the confines of careless theology. Peter and John are declaring this new covenant relationship, talking about the resurrection of Jesus and how people can experience the forgiveness of sins through the finished work of Christ on the cross. And as they're declaring the resurrection of Jesus, the temple elite, the Sadducees, the priests within Jerusalem hear them talking about the resurrection. Now, the high priest, Annas, and his father-in-law, Caiaphas, who was the former high priest, hold a lot of political and spiritual influence within Israel. They are the aristocracy within the Jewish community. They oversee and protect and govern the temple system, which is the epicenter of the Jewish religious system. And it is commonly held that the priests were of the theology of the Sadducees. And the Sadducees held to the first five books of the law, Genesis through Deuteronomy. They believed that God's covenant centered around proper temple worship, but they would disagree with the theology of the Pharisees during the time of the apostles and Jesus. They didn't hold to the resurrection. They didn't believe that there was an afterlife. Other things that they let go of in their theology, they didn't believe in angels or demons. There wasn't a lot of mention of those things in the first five books of the law. So they were devout and experts within the law, but their theology and their denial of the resurrection is actually what's getting in the way of them coming into this new covenant with Jesus. See, sometimes our theology can actually be a hindrance to us experiencing all that God has for us. Jesus warned the people about theology becoming your God when in John chapter 5, he was at the temple in Jerusalem during another event. He was speaking to the people and he said the following words in John 5:39, "You diligently study the scriptures because you think that by them you possess eternal life. These are the scriptures that testify about me, yet you refuse to come to me to have life. Do not think I will accuse you before the Father. Your accuser is Moses, on whom your hopes are set. If you believed Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote about me." What Jesus is saying to the people in Jerusalem at that point, and certainly what the Holy Spirit might be stirring up within the priests and the Sadducees in this case, is that they had studied and become experts in the law, but they saw it as the ultimate fulfillment of all God's activity. And the whole purpose of the Old Testament was to prepare the hearts and minds of the people for the coming Messiah, Jesus, who was a fulfillment of the Old Testament laws. All of the Old Testament was pointing to a destination beyond itself, but people had studied it and formed a theology that wouldn't allow for this Messiah if he didn't come the way I thought he should, if he didn't speak the way I thought he might, if he wasn't the fulfillment of the God I had created out of Old Testament theology. They were hindered from actually seeing who Jesus was. And that was the case with the Sadducees. They didn't hold to a resurrection. So when Jesus even talked about the resurrection, when the apostles talked about the resurrection, it didn't mix with their theology. Their theology had become their God. And that's what's so disturbing to me when I read the Gospels. Here you have the Sadducees, the priests, the experts in the law, those who have studied their whole life. They have their masters of divinity, they have their masters of theology, and when the author of the word that they are an expert on is standing in front of them, they don't recognize him. Why that troubles me is that you could memorize scripture all you want and still not know Jesus. It's disturbing. And in our day and age, and certainly within my generation and a large number of young people that I encountered through Urban Promise, We had interns serve with us from all over the world. One of the disturbing trends I see is that there's a subtle letting go of theology or doctrine. We need to be students of His Word. We need to understand and feed and nourish on His Word because He is the Word. And it is living and active. And Paul writes to Timothy two letters, 1 and 2 Timothy, and it's one generation and trusting the next generation with leadership within the church. And he writes a few statements about the importance of doctrine. He says this, Paul writing to Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 4, he writes the following: "The Spirit clearly says that in later times some will abandon the faith and follow deceiving spirits and things taught by demons." And Paul's writing to the next generation and saying, this is going to come down the pipeline, and some will be taken away from the true faith outlined in the Gospels and in the New Testament to follow things that are taught by demons. And certainly as we look out over church history, we've seen numerous examples of that. And Paul writes in Galatians, even if we or an angel from heaven appears to you and declares a gospel other than the one you have already heard, let him be anathema, eternally cut off and condemned. And Paul's warning that the Spirit clearly says that in later times some will abandon the faith and follow deceiving spirits, things taught by demons, we see it play out time and time again. Our theology and our doctrine are important, and we can't handle it carelessly. We need to be students of His Word. We need to know the Jesus of Scripture, because all kinds of Jesuses are spoken of in our world today. And many of the Jesuses declared in our world today are not the Jesus you find in Scripture. Jesus warned His disciples that this was going to happen. Many will come and say that they are the Christ, but they're not me. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, again, Paul, writing to Timothy, says, "Watch your life and doctrine closely, persevere in them." In 2 Timothy, he says, "The time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around themselves a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths." And don't we see that in our day and age? People who take certain scriptures, form a theology out of it that does not describe Jesus, and it's a doctrine that is suited to their own desires. It's a doctrine that is based on myths. It's elaborate in its scheme, but it actually takes people away from the God of Scripture. I remember playing road hockey a couple years ago with my boys. It was a day similar to today, sunny outside, pleasant day. And we were out there with the road hockey sticks, and as we were playing around, I saw people in suits and dresses come around the corner with some literature in their hands. And I don't want to engage in a long conversation right now, so I did the no eye contact theory. I was just looking at the ground. I wired a few slap shots really hard at the net, giving an indication that if you came over, you might happen to get hit by an errant shot. Again, it wasn't my best moment. But sure enough, they came over to engage me in a conversation, talked about eternal life. I just went straight for the jugular. And I said to them, "I would discuss this with you, but I don't think that the Jesus you proclaim is the same one that I encounter in Scripture. The Jesus you proclaim is actually, in your theology, the archangel Michael, who, when he took on human form, was given the name Jesus. So Jesus, in your theology, is the archangel Michael. Is that correct?" And, you know, you get this paralyzed look on the other side. Our adversary is very crafty, and he seeks to hold the world captive, and he will even do it with chapter and verse Bible scriptures and get our theology twisted and our sound doctrine contaminated to take people prisoner to a Jesus that isn't the real Jesus. And the Sadducees have been careless in their theology. Jesus has spoken to them about their theology right on the week that he was crucified. But there's also a technical aspect to what they are doing. They've seen a miraculous sign and wonder take place through Peter and John. And because they're experts in the law, they're just following that law to the letter and convening a trial because they're instructed to do so in Deuteronomy chapter 13. Let me read to you what Deuteronomy 13 says, because it explains why the Sadducees and the priests and the temple guard arrest Peter and John. And it says this in Deuteronomy 13. If a prophet or one who foretells by dreams appears among you and announces to you a sign or wonder, and if the sign or wonder spoken of takes place, and the prophet says, let us follow other gods, gods you have not known, and let us worship them, you must not listen to the words of that prophet or dreamer. The Lord your God is testing you to find out whether you love him with all your heart and with all your soul. It is the Lord your God you must follow, in him you must revere, keep his commands and obey him, serve him and hold fast to him. That prophet or dreamer must be put to death for inciting rebellion against the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt and redeemed you from the land of slavery. Now these guys are all experts in the law. They're aware of Deuteronomy 13. This dramatic miracle has taken place. And so they place Peter and John under arrest in obedience in their minds to Deuteronomy 13 to investigate as to whether these two are drawing the nation of Israel away from the Old Testament God. So they are trying to be good stewards and leaders of the people. Now we move into the courage of truth. Peter and John have been arrested by the temple elite. They've been put in prison. And they've seen how this plays out. A few months prior to this event taking place, they were there when Jesus was arrested. They were present when Jesus was on trial. They saw justice perverted within those courts that subsequently led to Jesus being crucified. And so I wonder how Peter and John felt that night as they lay in prison in an eerily similar situation to what they had seen a few months prior. And we know from the Gospels that a few months prior, when Jesus was arrested and had his trial, Peter, who had said to Jesus that he would go with him to the death, Peter, who was so confident in his abilities as a Christ follower that he thought he could go the distance with Jesus, denied Christ three times that he ever even knew him. And Peter finds himself in the exact same situation, maybe wondering that he might die the next day. And Peter's being brought before a test again. And the purpose of a test that comes into our lives isn't to teach us something. It's to prove what we've already learned. Think about it like a school teacher. A school teacher teaches their students information, then administers a test to prove what they've already taught them and to see if they've learned it, right? God allows tests into our lives, but he's already provided us with the information that we might pass the test. So if you're at a point in your life that you seemingly are stuck in the same test over and over, you might want to review your experience and go, okay, God, maybe I'm not listening to you the way I ought to. Maybe you've already given me what I need to pass through this test because you're giving it to prove what I've already learned. And Peter and John are in this situation being tested. But as we see in the text, we notice a very different Peter, don't we, than a few months prior. The next day they're brought before trial, and look at the question again. Deuteronomy 13 is right at the forefront of this question in verse 7. They're brought before Annas and Caiaphas, the very people that had Jesus crucified, and they're asked the question, by what power or what name did you do this? They are asking about Deuteronomy 13. And if Peter and John declare a God other than the God of the Old Testament, they're in big trouble because they would have a legal mandate to stone them to death. And Peter, when faced maybe with certain death by the statements he's about to make and the sin that he's about to bring to their attention, declares the following in verse 8, "Rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a cripple and are asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth," listen to what he says next, "whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed." And Peter says, "He is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the capstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved." Do you see a different Peter than a few months prior? A few months prior, we see a Peter who's denying even to a servant girl in the courtyard that he ever knew Jesus. What we see in the Peter in this account is one filled with courage and declaring boldly the sin of the people and that salvation is found in none other than Jesus Christ. What is so different about Peter? Well, we're told in the text in verse 8, here is the key difference in Peter's life. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, filled with Christ in him, filled with the fullness of Christ, declaring to the elders and leaders of Israel their crime in nailing Christ to the cross, but extending to them an invitation into the saving life of Christ. It is Christ himself that is the difference in Peter's life. It's not Peter's external decision to not fail again. It is solely the filling of the Holy Spirit. And the Sanhedrin notice a different Peter and John, which is one of my favorite verses in all of Scripture. In verse 13, when they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished, and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. I absolutely love that verse, especially in the original Greek language. That word, unschooled, in the original Greek is idiotesy. So let me read it with our modern day language. When they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were idiots, ordinary men. Now, it didn't mean that. All it meant in the original New Testament was literally they were unschooled. They hadn't had access to higher education. And Peter and John are from a blue-collar background. They are Galileans. And they're standing before the religious elite. They're standing before royalty. They're standing before those who have studied their whole life and are experts in all things about the law. And these unschooled, ordinary, blue-collar men are filled with the Holy Spirit, speaking God's word, declaring to them their need of salvation. And the good news of that is God does not need your education. God does not need your pedigree. All he needs you to be is ordinary. Isn't that liberating? All we have to be is unschooled, ordinary people. And they took note that he had spent time with Jesus. So can I just suggest to you this week, if you ever feel unqualified to share your faith with someone else, if you ever feel like you're not articulate enough, you're in good company. I would rather be an idiot for Jesus than someone who has all the education in the world but does not know him. Now, parents, I am not saying that education is not important. So if you feel the Holy Spirit leading you to write a letter this week to me, let me save you all that time and energy and effort. I believe education is important. I believe it is one of the essential ingredients to our learning. I'm all for studying. But let us not make the mistake of focusing and having our confidence in our education and neglecting cultivating a relationship with Christ. And these unschooled, ordinary men respond to the question that they were asked, by what power or what name did you do this? They declare the name of Jesus. And when you study their sermon in Acts chapter 3, they have been led by the Spirit to attach the message of Jesus to the Old Testament. In Acts chapter 3, they declare that the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that Moses, all pointed to Jesus. And all they're saying is that he is the Messiah that we've been waiting for. And Peter, being led by the Spirit to root his response to the Sanhedrin in Psalm 118, verse 22, when he quotes, "The stone you builders rejected, which has become the capstone," what he's quoting is Psalm 118, verse 22, and he's saying, this has taken place in our midst. I'm not advocating a God distinct or different from the Old Testament. All I am declaring is that Jesus is who we've been waiting for. And this unschooled, uneducated man, an ordinary man who may not even be aware of the Deuteronomy 13 provision, answers them. But in the midst of his discourse, Peter utters a verse that, in my opinion, is the central verse of this text and probably the most important verse in all of human history. Now, let me qualify that statement. I'm not saying that it captures the fullness of the new covenant. I'm not saying that any one sermon could unpack the full counsel of God's word. But this verse stands out distinct because the implications of it across human history are the most important truth you will ever hear in your life. And it's when Peter says this in verse 12, "Salvation is found in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved." And that statement begs a question. When Peter says, we must be saved, saved from what? In Romans chapter 3, God declares his case against humanity when he says the following in Romans 3, verse 9, "We have already made the charge that Jews and Gentiles alike, all of humanity, all are under the power of sin. As it is written, there is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. Their throats are open graves, their tongues practice deceit, the poison of vipers is on their lips, their mouths are full of cursing and bitterness, their feet are swift to shed blood, ruin and misery mark their ways, and the way of peace they do not know. There is no fear of God before their eyes." That is God's case against humanity in Romans chapter 3. And if we look out over our world today, it would be a hard case to argue against. 15 years ago, we witnessed a heinous act of terrorism. We stand there horrified, being reminded that there is good in the world and there is evil in the world. And all you have to do is listen to the news every week, every day, or read your newspaper. None of us would disagree that there's something wrong in the world, that there is the presence of evil in the world. I looked at the newspaper yesterday as I was reading through it. There were stories of theft. There were stories of murder, wars taking place. There is a sin condition within humanity, and God declares it in Romans chapter 3. Now, it's easy for us to stand and look at those heinous acts and go, yes, there is sin out there. But would we all have a moment of honesty this morning and acknowledge that that very sin principle is active in our city? There are thefts, There are murders. There are sexual sins that are pervasive within our city. And if we could even be more honest this morning, would we acknowledge that it's within our own households? That sometimes we say words to our wife or to our husband or to our children. And when we're alerted to what we just said, we're horrified by what came out of our mouth. And Romans 3 says to us, their throats are open graves, their tongues practice deceit, the poison of vipers is on their lips. And God is a righteous judge. And in his justice, he has to judge sin. And so we stand before him guilty. And so we need to be saved from sin. And Jesus, when it was announced that he would be born, an angel appeared to Joseph as he was preparing to get married to Mary and said the following statement in Matthew 1, verse 21. An angel appears to Joseph and says the following, "She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." I want to make this as simple as possible for every single one of us in this room to understand. So we're going back to Sunday school. I want to make this so easy for you to understand. Our sin has created a separation between us and God. We are on one side, and we are estranged and separated from God. And no amount of religious good behavior can atone for our sins. No matter how hard you try, no matter how devout you were, no matter what expertise you had in his word, no matter how many verses you've memorized, there is nothing, absolutely nothing, that you can do to earn God's favor by your good works. Make sense? You could try and run off that cliff and jump to the other side. And I don't care if your Mother Teresa and your life was great, if you think Mother Teresa's life was great, whoever's life, it all falls short of who he is. But the good news is it doesn't end there. That is why he sent his son, his one and only begotten son, to die on a cross and cover and atone for our sins and build a bridge back between us and God. When Peter stands and declares in their midst, "Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved," Peter and Scripture, filled with the Holy Spirit, is declaring that there is no other avenue by which we are reconciled in our relationship with the one true God. There is no plan B. There is no other avenue. There is no other world religion. There is nothing else but Christ and Christ himself. There is no other name under heaven by which we must be saved. It's interesting to note that Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, says, "Salvation is found in no one else." Salvation is not found in a system of religion. It is not found in external rule keeping. It is found in a person, and that person's name is Jesus Christ. And in Romans 10, 13, we read the verse that says, "Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." So the good news today is, if you would but acknowledge that there's something wrong with the world, that there's something wrong with our city, that there's something wrong with you, and that thing is sin, no matter how hard you try, you fall short of the glory of God. If you would but acknowledge that before him and look to Christ as your Savior and realize that his death on the cross satisfied the holiness of God, that by his shed blood, your sins are forgiven. If you call on his name, you shall be saved. And Peter's declaring this to the Sadducees and the priests, who are all experts and have their theologies formed. And God has made it plainly evident through the miracle that took place with this lame man, through the message that Peter and John have declared. Literally, it's the Holy Spirit speaking to them, saying, this is the one way, there is no old covenant. Wouldn't you think that the religious leaders, the Sadducees, the priests, Annas, Caiaphas, and the family, seeing that healed man before them, would start to review their theology about the resurrection? They send Peter and John out, and their response to what they see, this man who has been healed standing before them, Peter's conviction of their sin, saying, you have rejected God's anointed. Their response to what they see in the words that are spoken to them is that they call Peter and John back in and command them not to speak to anyone in this name. See, friends, the name of Jesus is different than any other name in human history. There is something about that name. And the good news is that by the end of chapter 5, a large number of priests who were Sadducean in their theology converted to Christianity and put their faith in that name. And this text displays the absolute grace of God to send his prophets to preach a message of forgiveness to the very people that sentenced his one and only son to death. God's love is amazing. If you are here today and you don't know that name personally, there are pastors here who afterwards will pray with you, but it's a day to do business with God. And it's a day by which you can invite Jesus to be your personal savior so that your sins might be forgiven. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for the name of Jesus and all that it is and means and represents and who he is. King of kings and Lord of lords. We thank you that no matter what, in the future, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that he is Lord to your glory. I pray for anyone here today who does not know you, they would fall completely into your arms, into your grace, into your mercy, into your love for us, expressed by the finished work of Christ on the cross. I pray that everybody who's here this morning would walk out liberated and free, not because of their efforts, but because of the work of Christ. We ask this in Jesus' name, amen.
The Sadducees were sure of what they believed the scriptures taught. They were seemingly smart men, yet their theology had disregarded the resurrection, life after death, and heavenly beings. It actually made it difficult for them to accept the new covenant, founded on the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's possible to be studying the Word of God, know the law in great detail, and yet completely miss an encounter with the living God. People can easily form their own theology based on a selection of scriptures, which then becomes a misrepresentation of Christ. Our theology and doctrine matter. Who we learn from, what we're influenced by. We have to know the Word of God so well that we recognize the counterfeit.
The book of Acts chronicles the amazing growth of the early church, giving us a glimpse into the purpose of the church in the world. Acts helps us to understand how the church grew from a small gathering of disciples in the Gospels into something that pervaded the whole known world, and that Jesus continues to teach through his body, the church. This series by Brett McBride is available on CD and DVD. Learn at home, give to a friend, or plan a group Bible study. To order your series, write to the address on your screen or call 1-416-222-3341, extension 289. To order online, visit livingtruth.ca. This summer, experience the transforming power of God's Word. Contact us today.
A person's name can be a doorway into knowing who they are. And that is certainly true of God. God has many names. Names that reveal his character, who he is, and also how we can relate to him. How can we be confident that when we are coming to Jesus, that we are not just learning about him, but that we are getting to know him? Big question.
It's a big question.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, I suppose partly it's connected to where your relationship with Christ is at the beginning. If you're a seeker and you're coming in to have a look at the Bible and to read scriptures, but you haven't really put your faith and trust in him, then maybe that would be different. But I think if you really are a Bible-believing Christian, if you really have known him for a while, I think it's the way that you read. I think it's as you're reading the scripture, you're sort of talking to the Lord at the same time, or at least that's how I would do it. So that it's like, Lord, what are you saying to me? How is this, how is this relating to me? What are you saying to me? So I'm not just understanding something or gaining information, but I'm having a conversation with the Lord at the same time.
And we must keep mindful of the fact that the Bible is true, but it's not the truth. The truth is Jesus. Mm. The Bible points us to Jesus. So we're not Bible worshipers, we're Christ worshipers. And if the Bible becomes the end in itself without being the actual means to an end, we're talking about the author of this book, not the book is our life. And I think there's many religious people who know the Bible very well, but have no relationship with Jesus. And that is a world of difference, a world of difference.
For people looking to make sure that they are getting to know the person of Jesus, any other thoughts or suggestions?
Well, I suppose as you're reading, it is a complicated thing, actually, this whole idea of Jesus is the Word, but the Bible is not actually, we're having a relationship with God through Christ. I suppose I have an example because my husband works a lot with theology and with people who are very excited and interested in theology. And sometimes it can tip over into being, for some of the people that he would interact with, they're more excited about the theology than they are about the Lord. And so it becomes an exercise in academics, or it becomes an exercise in debate or discussion, or what do you think about this point? And there's nothing wrong with getting excited about certain parts of Scripture, I think it's knowing, is this, in the end, am I actually being obedient to the Lord? Am I learning these things in order to follow him, to make him known, to actually be living a life that's worthy of him? Or am I just sort of studying for studying's sake? Mm-hmm.
Pastor Brett talked about the fact that we've often believed that when we go through a difficult time in life, it's a test of sorts, and that God is trying to teach us something. But he suggested that perhaps when we go through something, the purpose of it isn't to teach us something, but to prove what we have already learned.
Isn't that why teachers, good teachers, give quizzes in class? You know, class, take out your pens and write 1 to 10, and here's 10 questions, and you can't study for it. But I want you to know how much you know, and I want to know how much you know. So I give this quiz so that we can now build our lesson around, oh, actually, you don't know anything about this, right? Because your test paper. And that's like, oh, that's right. I got 3 out of 10, so I need to listen. So God knows everything. He knows what we know. That's never the issue, but we've got to be co-laborers together with him, and that's why he tests us sometimes to say, oh, you're right, I need to be taught in this, and he's so gracious, he teaches us. I think testing is really, really important.
Yeah. I mean, say, for example, you're struggling with courage to share your faith, and so you've been praying about it, and you feel that the Lord's given you that, yes, this is right, I do trust him, I'm going to speak out. But until there's a circumstance when you're sort of tested to actually do that, you don't know that you've got that courage. You can say, you know, I feel confident to do it, but until you're in that circumstance and you actually have to step out and do it.
Do either of you have a personal example that comes to mind on this, an issue where you did feel, you know, tested in something, for an opportunity for God to show you how he's been working in you?
I found I'm always tested. I'm not a very patient person, and I want answers. And I'm constantly tested in the counseling situation. I wish they could only, you know, find a quick answer, but most answers aren't quick. I can't put a marriage together again. It's like, oh, it's way beyond what I could possibly do. I want to, but I can't. So it's an enabling kind of thing. God, you've got to help me, give me the words. And sometimes people say, you know, when you said this, that really meant a lot. I said that? I don't remember mm-hmm. saying that. Well, that sounds very wise. Well, yeah, it's mm-hmm. a silent W in my name. But it's like, no, so I'm constantly learning. Actually, it seems like the same lesson over and over and over again. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What about you, Jenny?
This whole sermon is very meaningful to me. Just the way that he says there is no other name but the name of mm-hmm. Jesus Christ. Just to say so boldly what we all know to be true, mm-hmm. but just knowing in our culture now that it's very hard to say there is one way and it's Jesus Christ. Even to say the name Jesus Christ in our culture is becoming more and more difficult. So, just quite recently, I've got some friends who I would say are not Christians, they're not believers, and I've been getting to know them. And I'm always scared to step over into those kind of conversations. But more recently, I've felt that as I've prayed about it, I've been able to say more and be who I am more. And just at certain times, I've had to say, you know, no, I wouldn't be able to do that. Or, you know, I don't agree with that.
Bringing the name of Jesus and because Christianity, you don't have to agree with what Christianity teaches, but you can't change what it teaches. And the Bible says there is no other name. But you even bringing that into a conversation, it's like often very awkward, but it is the one thing that you can agree with a lot of other things about Christianity, loving your neighbors and that's so good stuff. But it's like the real nub of it, the real gist is it is Jesus Christ who says he is the way. This is his claim. And if we're really following him, we can't change that.
Remember this encouragement from today's message. God does not need your education, your skills, or your pedigree. All he needs you to be is ordinary. Why? Because salvation is found in the person of Jesus Christ. I certainly find that to be important. The Apostle Peter was able to declare boldly that the crippled man was healed by the power of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Christ himself gave him the courage to do this by the power of the Holy Spirit living in him. We have that same power. There'll be many times when it's personally difficult for us to tell others about Christ or even to mention his name publicly. And we might be tempted to alter his words and his requirements to suit our environment. But we don't want to give people a Jesus of our own making. It's only his true name revealed to us in the Word of God that saves, heals, and restores the world. Join us next time for more clear biblical teaching here on Living Truth.
To watch this message again, visit our website, download transcripts, order DVDs and CDs, as well as our daily devotional, or sign up for our monthly newsletter. Online, you can sign up for podcasts. You can also join us on Facebook and YouTube.
Join us next week for more clear biblical teaching from Brett McBride.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. then bursting forth in glorious day. Up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. Guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand, till he returns, calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I stand.